Welcome everyone, this is Frank from Optics Warehouse. As a former sniper myself, I thought it would be very interesting to talk you through part of the evolution and the development of sniper rifles from World War II until the modern day. So what we've got in front of us here, we've got three rifles, one which I've used myself personally, which isn't the World War II one, from a 1942 Lee-Enfield Mark I with a telescope fitted, which is the number 4T, to my old favourite, the L96A1, Accuracy International Supply and Rifle, with the ×6 Smith & Bender scope. It's a good British rifle with a good German scope on it. Up until today's fairly modern, although there are new versions of this now, of the AX multi-caliber, again Accuracy International supplied, again surprise surprise, with a German optic on it, in this case Smith & Bender 5-25x56. Of course the optics, anything can be fitted on a modern rifle like this, but as you can see the sort of caliber is fairly universal. On the Lee-Enfield we had 303 caliber. The L96 was 7.62, 51, standard NATO round. And today we have, on the multi-caliber, we still use 7.62. But interestingly enough, this rifle can be converted to take 300 Win Mag and also 0.338 Lapua Magnum. In a minute, I'm going to talk about the rifles individually and give you a bit of history about them all. Suffice to say that we had a rifle then which was in service from World War II up until the Falklands War and a little bit after. This rifle came along when I was a young sniper, introduced into the military around about 1987-88, and it went out of service in 2013. When it was taken out of service, it had as much life as the Spitfire had, and again, like the Spitfire, it was much loved, and there was a lot of moaning when this came out of service. Now this calibre was replaced with the .338 cartridge, which again in battle has jumped the distance of engagement. So we've gone from the L96 days of 900 killing, harassing at 1100, jumping right out to 1450 nanometers with the .338 calibre. All the rifles are sniper rifles. Well, Lee-Enfield was actually an infantry rifle, and it was chosen because possibly it was a very good shooting and accurate barrel, and it was converted to the sniper grade rifle, whereas the L96 was a bespoke rifle built. It was a radical rifle of its day, but it was built exclusively for snipers and sharpshooters. Today's Accuracy International rifle again, it is another one of their great products, and this one is again delivered for snipers, law enforcement, sharpshooters, and people in that trade. Okay, so we're going to have a look a little bit more in depth at the number 4T. So this rifle is also fitted with a telescope. It's a ×4 pad scope. It's called the number 32 scope. Imperial settings on the drum, which denote to the age. Interesting enough, this scope and an improved version was later used on the L42, which is a rifle which was in service during the Falklands War and up until the sort of late 80s. The only thing that changed is it was now metric and not imperial. The rifle itself is a standard, but maybe a more accurate shooting version of the standard Lee-Enfield number 4. Points note on the rear, we've got a raised cheekpiece. Now this gives the cheek weld nice and tight so that your natural alignment through the scope is very important. Remember the four aspects of shooting is sight alignment, aiming, breathing, and of course trigger control. So to get the alignment, the cheek weld and the cheekpiece needs to be raised to give you that good alignment for the scope. The scope's got your elevation and your windage, which is on the side there. And again, the rifle's got a barrel, emergency battle sights, and a 10-round magazine. In combat, it was a good rifle. There were some variations where the scope was offset at the top. Again, this dated back to World War II, and in fact, not only was the number 4 in service, but also the P-14 rifle and P-17 were also used as various guises as sniper rifles. An old boy I knew was a sniper in the Battle of Arnhem in 1944. He was a gliderman, and he carried this rifle. I remember him telling me that his typical engagement ranges were 200, 300 and 400 yards, which with this sort of setup was quite realistic. The rifle was could shoot out well in excess of 1,000 yards, but really sniper fighting in those days was very short and close up. Okay, now here we're moving on to the R96. Now this was a rifle that I spent a lot of time with in the military. Went on many operations carrying this rifle. The great thing about this compared to some other weapon systems is the snipers in the day had a lot of confidence of carrying this rifle. Maybe you'd carry a Browning pistol, 9mm pistol, grenades, but this rifle was carried. Some units would use it in a drag bag, but generally you had the greatest confidence in this rifle. Quick introduction to the rifle. Obviously we've got an adjustable butt pad. We haven't got a cheek piece in this, so some of the modifications snipers were doing was adding bits of foam, like from a roll mat or a sleeping mat, onto there to raise the cheek position. We had a x6 Smith & Benner scope, which was the L13A1, the L13A1. x6, but again, obviously metric, with the ability to, by using the sniper telephone number, which was a system of adjusting the sight, this rifle was graduated out to 900 metres. Again, harassing fire, which is where you're putting rounds down, maybe not killing, but certainly suppressing or winning the firefight. In the sniper's book, putting lethal or almost lethal shots on the target out to 1,100 metres. Very long length, 26-inch barrel. This one's got the foresight blade still fitted on it. It was common occurrence for snipers to remove these, but we did have an emergency battle sight, a leaf sight, which was at the rear here. And again, with all weapon systems of that era, these were the backup sights. What was great about this rifle, though, this rifle was built with ideas from some of the best shooting rifles of the time. Three characters really influenced this rifle. The first one was Dave Walls, who is now and still the director of ACUS International. Dave Kaig, who was his partner. Dave Walls shot for Great Britain internationally, and Dave Walls shot for Scotland. And with their design and engineering, they came up with this rifle. Later, they met Malcolm Cooper, and between the three of them, ACUS International was born. Now, Malcolm Cooper was the gold medal winner at the time and the real sort of shooter. So between them, the three of them came up with this radical design. Now, they entered the trial because to wind it back slightly in the Falklands War, the rifle, the L-42, was struggling. There were some excessively long kills made with it, but generally it was dated. It was a World War II sort of rifle, but it was totally out of date and out of class, as were a lot of equipments and weapons which were used in the Falklands War, ranging from the Navy to some of the missile systems. So again, the Army and the MOD was looking at replacing this. So ACUS International fielded this rifle. They never intended to do well in the trial, but actually as the trial went on, suddenly they were down to the last couple and narrowly beating the M85 Parker Hull. The early version of the R96 was accepted into service. Some modifications were made, and the rifle you see before you was the one that won the contract for over 1,100 rifles. And again, I was one of the receivers of his rifle, and it was much loved. In combat, overnight, the effect of his rifle jumped 300 metres from its predecessor, the L42. Later on, a night vision, the CWS, was swapped, and the kite sight, so we could take the sight off and swap it for your night vision. So it was a case of swapping them over. Later upgrades, which were sort of battle proven, were the introduction of the Smith & Bender 3-12 by 50 PM2 sight, and also a rail, which would allow the night vision, like the stick sight, to be employed with this rifle. Not many changes were made to this rifle. This rifle was used for many years and was extremely loved. In fact, this rifle here, this is still capable of shooting a minute of angle at all ranges using the old 144 grain green spot ammunition, which is no mean feat. What a lovely rifle. Okay, so now introducing another product by AXMC International. This is the AXMC, AXMC International Multi-Caliber System. Now, this rifle, this what you see before you, is not actually in service with the MOD. However, it's used by many countries around the world. There are very good sniper rifles out there, as well as AXMC International, but this is the particular variant which is in service with many sniper groups and law enforcement groups. And in the British Army, we have some variants of this, both in 338 and 7.62. But fundamentally, the rifle is much the same. Just to talk you through it, so of course, the evolution of sniping, what we've gone from is quite a high profile bipod, and again with the Lee-Enfield, no bipod at all, to a nice, sleek, low shooting position. The great thing about the L96, it forced you into a natural shooting position. It's again with this rifle, as you can see, it's almost solid. And now it forces you to get hold of a rifle into a shooting position, which is unlike your normal traditional positions. So the rifle's making you work rather than the other way around. Profile is nice and low. And as you can see, the weapon's pointing naturally at the target. Technically, all I have to do is just take up the trigger pressure, control my breathing, check my alignment, and squeeze, breathe out, and let the shot out. So that's the sort of setup of it. Of course, on this system, like many of the other variants, we have an instant adjust cheek and butt. Got a two-stage trigger, so that we can pull the trigger back, hold it, and then squeeze and release the shot. And also we can hold it back, and if we're not going to take the shot, sniper's off, we can release the trigger. This one's mounted with a Smith & Bender 5-25x56. We've got the sniper hider fitted forward of this. This is part of the CS for the new rifle. The CS is the complete equipment schedule. Very good optical scope. Reality is, people normally have the scope sit on times 10 or 12, but you have the ability to move it into 25 and to identify targets out to 2,000 metres. Because remember, in today's modern sniping, PID, positively identifying a target, is very important. Every bullet you fire has your name on it. So consequently, we've got a more powerful scope, which is used not just for surveillance, but obviously for measuring the distance to the target by using the mil dot or the reticle, and obviously for acquiring your shot. On this multi-caliber, we've got an Allen key fitment here. We can undo this Allen nut, and by doing that, the barrel can be removed. In front of me here, I have the fully suppressed barrel. So inside there, we've got a 16-inch short barrel and then a long sleeve. Now, by using subsonic ammunition, again, remember, if you think of a principle of the jet aircraft breaking the sound barrier, the bullet is much the same. So subsonic bullet is going to just stop short of the sound barrier. That's why it's subsonic. A normal conventional round is supersonic, so it would break the sound barrier, and that's why you get the noise. So this rifle can be totally silenced, hence the configuration there. The magazine itself as you can see, and I'll carefully show you, it's got the cutout so it will take a larger magazine such as 338 caliber. We've got the Harris bipod fitted. We've got a rail forwards. Now this is the first time we see this on these rifles. I mentioned on the L96, but now we've got a continual rail, and I'll explain why this is important in a minute. And on this one we have the tactical muzzle brake. So again, we've now got a muzzle brake. Onto that muzzle brake, we can also put a tactical suppressor. Now suppressor, its main function is it's a flash hider. Certainly in the fight in Afghan, particularly in 2006, one of the biggest problems was when the shots were taken, particularly in low light, even though the flash eliminators on there, there was still an element of flash going off. And of course, it was a bit of a joke, people putting on, having to put on their helmets, body armour, even snipers, to take shots. So what was required was a flash hider, a more improved one. And this is with a moderate or tactical suppressor, as it's known in the military, was issued. And again, that would just screw on the front there, and it would almost hide your flash. I talked about the rail. The rail system here is important because the evolution of night fighting means that we've gone from having to remove the scope and put a night vision scope on it to having an offset scope like the Simrad. Now everything's in line. The sniper hider can be removed and we can fit your night vision optic on there. And again, it keeps that nice low profile, enabling you to have less of a profile being offered towards the target. So this is the AXMC. Very good rifle, and you can see the evolution from the number 4T to the L96 and to this rifle. Underneath this is an L96. All the elements which were much loved and were radical in the day are still very much relevant on this rifle. So what we're going to do is put these weapons to the acid test. So we're going to shoot the 303 Lee-Enfield. And let's see how we get on. Okay, so there we have it, number 4T sniper rifle, dated 1942. Still shooting about 2 minutes of angle, not bad for its age, and quite a good meaty weapon to shoot. So, moving on now, and excuse the smile on my face, this is a rifle very dear and familiar to me, the L96A1. Obviously, a lot of people in the British Army would have carried this rifle and used it all around the world in various operations. People describe climbing into the Spitfire, particularly fighter pilots from World War II, the smell, the familiarity, the just beauty of climbing inside. It's the same with this rifle, so I'm going to enjoy this. There we are, the L96 with the old L13A1 times 6 Smith & Bender scope. Great combination, really nice. Big part of my sort of my background is this weapon, as is a lot of the snipers of my era and age. What a great weapon. It's just a real pleasure to shoot this. And the shooting down there, it's just shot all the bullets into one small pattern. Fantastic. Okay, so finally for today, we're going to move on to the AX series rifle. This one is the AX multi-caliber, AXMC. In this guise, it's in the 7.62 or 308 mode. We've purposely left the tactical suppressor off the end, but we are using a slightly overpowered scope for this caliber. But of course, being a multi-caliber, perfectly suited for the 338 caliber. The scope is a Smith & Bender 5x25x56. Forward of it, we have the sniper hider, which is fully open at the minute. And apart from that, it's a general standard configuration. So we're going to fire 5 rounds, and you'll see how this shoots differently to the number 4T and the L96. Again, each of these rifles is like a step, an evolution step. What you've got to think is underneath here is an L96, and all the things they wanted to improve on that had been put into this weapon series. Okay, so without further ado, we get loaded up and see how we get on. So there we are, a little bit of rapid bolt there, just showing how versatile these weapons are, and then slowing it down, nice slow methodical sniping with the empty cases retained. Yeah, very good weapon system. Nice and comfortable, easy to shoot, easy to get on the target, and yeah, much light. And it really filled the L96 inside this. Okay, so in summary then, we've got three great sniper rifles which in their day have revolutionised and changed the face of sniping within the British Army. So if you've enjoyed watching this video, please subscribe. My name is Frank from Optics Warehouse.